thanks for joining us today, Dr. Venter. As you heard, I have had the great honor for almost a decade now, actually over a decade now, to work with you. Let me get this plant out of the way. Primarily at synthetic genomics and secondarily at HLI, or Human Longevity, Inc. And as everyone here in the audience knows, this has been a pioneer in the fields of genomics, from sequencing the first human genome, which not surprisingly was his, and then the first diploid full sequence, and a number of other things which we'll get into. So perhaps as a transition, I'd love to hear a bit about what's new and exciting, the developments of late, because that's often what I find most interesting. But if I may, just to set the stage, can you share with us some of your thoughts on why HLI exists? Why is there an opportunity or a need, depending on your point of view, to approach healthcare or aging or longevity from a different perspective than traditional biotech companies might?
Oh, it's a good question, because it kind of evolved into what we're doing. Mm-hmm. So 15 years ago or 17 years ago now, when we sequenced the first genome, it cost 100 million and took 9 months to do. So it was not a very replicable event. There weren't people lining up to get their genome sequenced like they are to go to space. So I've essentially been waiting and had certain criteria set, and 3 years ago they were passed. Sequencing got below $2,000 a genome. Mm-hmm. Computing totally changed, so with distributed and cloud computing, it made it possible to do the kind of computing that was needed. Then machine learning sort of came much more of age, and we combined the three together. The notion being to understand the 3% difference in all of us, we would need very large numbers of genomes, all with attached phenotype information. And so we set up what we call the health nucleus as a means of just getting lots of very precise phenotype data. Mm-hmm. And we're stunned almost immediately when we started, and it was all healthy people that were coming in and paying $25,000 to get a workup, that 40% of them had something significantly wrong. Mm-hmm. Many cancers, brain aneurysms, things that nobody could detect when they were early on. And so, the practice of medicine today is you wait till you have symptoms and you go to see somebody to try and sort out what those symptoms mean. And with cancer, it's usually detected after it's metastasized and is causing pain or disruption of some function somewhere. So in the health nucleus, we're discovering cancers at stage zero, stage one, and a couple at stage two, but all before they've metastasized.
Is this imaging analysis that typically...
For that, it's all imaging analysis. We have a wholly unique MRI technique that basically lights up malignant tumors by measuring the water molecule difference in tissues. And so tumor cells have slightly bigger nuclei, they have more water, but the water is less mobile, so it shows up totally different than in normal cells. So it's totally unique, and our lead radiologist has 100% batting average now on everyone he's diagnosed has been confirmed to be a serious tumor. It's totally was unexpected to us, but looking at the data, it shouldn't have been unexpected. So I can't see the age of the audience totally clearly, but people today, if you're sort of between 40 and older and a male, 40% of you will never reach the age of 74. So I can't tell if there's supposed to be around 300 people here, and if it was all males, it means 120 of you will not reach the age of 74. Statistics are better for females. 84% won't reach the age of 74. So the discoveries we were making all of a sudden became not so surprising, and it was more surprising that's not how medicine was practiced, because it was very easy to treat these tumors when you discover them early. Our goal was just to have this data to be able to interpret the genome so we could predict things very accurately in the future, and we're combining them very successfully. But it's turned into phenomenal early diagnostic in people that think they're healthy. And so the definition of health is so bizarre, it probably hasn't changed since the Middle Ages. If you don't have any symptoms and you feel and look okay, you're deemed by the health system to be healthy.
Mm-hmm.
We now have a system, we can tell you whether you're healthy or not.
On a positive, the positive side of normal.
That's right. At the current time, and predict what it's going to be. So we can predict whether you'll get Alzheimer's 20 years before you have the first symptoms, using a combination of genomics and the MRI imaging. So it's an exciting difference. And so when we talk about longevity, it's in the context of the close to 200 people that won't reach the age of 74.
So as you think about the work you're doing and how it actually promotes longevity, I can understand the early detection of a problem and presumably the excision of that tumor and dealing with it long before normal symptoms would show up and how that's life prolonging. Is there any other learning that you expect to come, or is it already starting to come, in terms of advice of how to live a healthier life, how to go onto the positive side of normal? Is it correlation studies, or are there some ways that you're pushing that?
Yeah, I mean, one of the most predictive parameters of how well somebody will do as they age is their muscle mass. So not BMI, but actual muscle mass. So because if you get too weak and you become immobile and you keep doing less and less because you're too weak, it's a very rapid decline. But you know, I think it's more interesting when you look at why those numbers of people are not reaching the age of 74. And two-thirds of the reasons are cancer and heart disease. Slightly more cancer in women, slightly more heart disease in men. And both are predictable and detectable at a stage where they can result in greatly prolonging people's lives. So that will change the life statistics and a healthy outcome. And we're getting, you know, each time with the machine learning and the correlation between what we're finding in the clinic and the genome, we're every day improving the predictability just from the genome. So the cheapest route is to do a full genome sequence and use that as a triage tool. It's not 100%, but you probably capture 60 or 70% of the major risk for cancer, major risk for heart disease. But the limitations are much of the scientific literature is wrong. The government databases, one called ClinVar that people use for analyzing the genome, 30 to 40% of it is just junk. And so you can't get a right answer with any of these things. So we're trying to redo the entire system. We have over 40,000 genomes now. And so we're starting to get very accurate data on haplotypes and allele frequency, so we can detect whether something is rare. The rarer it is, the more likely it is to be associated with a trait or disease. So it's getting pretty exciting, and the tools are changing very fast in this space. We've talked about remote monitoring and things. So there's just a simple patch we give people, they wear for 2 weeks, and it continually records your EKG. You know, pulse isn't so useful, but EKG is. And we found we're now five people that had episodic atrial fibrillation for up to 8 hours a day.
But you wouldn't have detected it if you didn't.
And they were completely unaware of it. You know, most people become aware of it if their heart starts beating really fast, but maybe this happens while they're sleeping or something. But AFib is one of the big risk factors for stroke, because clots sort of occur in the atrium while it's quivering.
Fluttering.
And so those people have been put right away on anticoagulants. And we had one person who had second-degree heart block and was completely unaware of it. So he was sudden cardiac death just waiting to happen. So he was in on a Friday. We didn't wait till Monday to tell him. And he was immediately put on a pacemaker. So remote devices and remote sensing, I think, are going to impact the space in the future quite a bit. You know, we can, with an iPhone, diagnose gait and diagnose Parkinson's disease. We have a slightly fancier version. We have an electronic floor that people walk across and measures the exact pressure of your toe and your heel and your balance, and you can diagnose a lot from that in terms of stability. And so it's part of the neurological test, but there hasn't been one of the tests we do that hasn't turned up something significant in people. Aneurysms were one of the biggest surprises, but—
Brain aneurysms?
Well, brain aneurysms, but just aneurysms in general. And it turns out, you know, doing some work on this, one in 50 people have aneurysms and don't know it. Usually people discover they have a brain aneurysm because they have a sudden massive stroke and die. It's not a very good diagnostic tool. But almost everybody knows somebody that's died from a brain aneurysm at some stage. So, or they get discovered because they were get part of a study looking at something else in the brain.
So these blow, they start to balloon out long before they become fatal, and you can detect that?
Yes. Oh. Yeah, they sit there like on an inner tube, a bleb sticking out there, so it's a weak point. And if they burst, you know, it's just a massive bleed, and depending where they are, there's almost nothing you can do about them. But they're easy to treat now. So with intervention and radiology, they're treated as an outpatient. It takes about 30 minutes.
Put a little wire or something.
Put a little coil in there, and that eliminates the risk. So, you know, having that kind of risk for sudden death, and you know, there's no way you'd know without a brain MRI. But the nice thing we do, we don't use any contrast media because of these new techniques that are just unbelievable.
So you, the examples you give sound like cutting-edge imaging and other forms of imaging of all sorts,
yep.
Right? And running tests on people who don't present with symptoms and discovering things. That itself is advancing medicine in a way that traditional methods might not have discovered.
Well, it's very controversial with a lot of physicians. That they consider it wrong to do tests on healthy people. And my response is, how do you know they're healthy?
Mm-hmm.
40% of them aren't healthy.
Is that what you're finding?
Yeah. 1 in 40 we're finding significant cancer, but before it's metastasized. So that means if we just screened everybody here, we would find a major tumor in at least 8 of you. Hmm. Right?
Sure.
To me, those are worthwhile screens to do. Other people argue economically that they're not, but the costs of these tests are getting cheaper and cheaper. For those where we find the tumors, you know, we have lots of letters thanking us for saving their lives. It's really important in terms of prostate cancer because this new technique only detects high-grade prostate tumors. So there's two kinds of prostate cancers, the kind you die with and the kind you die from. So the high-grade tumors are the kind you die from. And we've diagnosed 4 of these now. 3 of the men had no symptoms and normal PSAs.
Hmm.
So they never would have even gotten an exam.
Wow.
They were high-grade enough that within the next 6 months to a year, they would have definitely metastasized. The capsule was starting to break. I mean, these were seriously high-grade tumors. The 4th one was me, which was a real surprise. I had elevated PSAs, I had biopsies, and they were all negative, so you know, I was totally confident that I didn't have prostate cancer, or if I had it, it was some low-grade version. And with the new MRI, you know, I'm usually the test subject for things. It turned out I had a very high-grade prostate tumor, and shortly after I had it removed, and 3 or 4 months later now, I'm completely cancer-free. But we didn't understand, I couldn't understand from my genome why I had a high-grade prostate cancer. So I had no oncogenes that were mutated that would increase risk for cancer. It just shows we have a very limited view of what an oncogene is. Early on, I had a melanoma, but knew how to detect those, and detected it very early and just had it removed, and it hadn't penetrated the dermis, so that was it. But you wouldn't consider behavioral genes part of risk for melanoma, but it is. You know, I spent every bit of my life that I could in the sun, either sailing or surfing or swimming or something, and that's not whatever genes that cause that behavior aren't considered oncogenes, but they should. But we couldn't figure out the prostate cancer, so we looked in the androgen pathway. And so our androgen receptor is on the X chromosome, and it turns out it's a triplet repeat gene, so there's CAG repeats in the androgen receptor. And if you have 22 or more of these CAG repeats, your risk of prostate cancer is extremely low. So if you have less than 22 repeats, it's extreme. It gets higher and higher. I only have 6 repeats. I have
only 6.
The lowest number. So the lower number of repeats, it causes a huge overexpression of the androgen receptor. You know, people always said I had balls of steel for all the risk I take, and now now we found the molecular basis of it. I only have 6 repeats in my androgen receptor.
Your sex hormones are all whack. Is what
but
you're saying.
What it means is, you know, hormonal response or balance between the hormone concentration and the receptor concentration. So, if you have overexpression of the receptor, just small amounts of hormone cause maximum activation.
Mm.
That's probably why I went bald at age 21, and adrenaline has always been my favorite drug, and I can probably attribute all that to those 6 repeats, but it gave me a greatly increased risk for prostate cancer. But even though my genome's been on the internet for 15 years, nobody knew this, nobody looked at it. We now screen people for that, and because it is a risk factor, and nobody would consider that in any pattern as a risk factor for prostate cancer, but it's a direct correlation.
So this is an interesting example of how the genome and these correlation studies are increasingly becoming more rich. In other words, you have this data set now for 40,000 people and growing. You have some phenotypic information, and that's growing. And I guess it seems sort of obvious that as time goes on, all of these people could have an enriched experience because you could go back retrospectively you learn new things. So tell us.
We send people updates every year on their genome, or sooner if we discover it. But it's really changing our interpretation very quickly of the genome. Right. And the machine learning, the best example of that is we did a study with 1,000 people where we took 3D photos of their faces.
Oh, yeah.
And then we used those as a training set to see if we could predict somebody's face just from their genetic code. And it's getting pretty good. So we can, if you just had a set of photos, most people can pick out 1 out of 10 pretty readily, but it's just a face mask right now.
Without the hair, of course.
So if you look at people around you, their main characteristic isn't their face mask, it's their hair, their hairstyle, skin tone, all kinds of things. And so we're getting from all the MRI images, we're getting so we can predict the shape of the skull.
It's amazing.
Adding ears seems to help, et cetera. So the predictions are getting better, but we can absolutely identify anybody now just from their genetic code.
Let's pause for a second. Think about the forensic science potential here. If police have a snippet of DNA at a crime scene, you know, who is it?
Right? Yeah. Well, it's a combination of the photo. Mm-hmm. So we give people their, if we get a genome report from us, you get your predicted photo. By the way, your photo is predicted roughly just post-puberty. We had no idea what age, you know, your genome would predict what you would look like. Huh. But it's sort of at sexual maturity, which I guess makes sense. We predict your height, your weight, your eye color, your hair color. I don't know if any of you watched the Chelsea Handler show. So she wanted her genome sequenced, and I had to go on her show live to give her her report. And I said, your genome predicts that you will weigh 166 pounds. Hmm. And her response was, fuck you. And I said, look, some people exceed their genome potential. Some people don't totally fulfill it. So, you know.
Always a charmer.
I said, if you work at it, you can defy your genome. But she was not pleased with that prediction. So we get all these characteristics, but it's getting so now because of information on the internet, and a study was done just with a Y chromosome haplotype, mm-hmm. and this group did a study using my genome. You can take a Y chromosome haplotype and go to the internet and usually find a site with a surname associated with that haplotype. So if you just have two bits of information for a male, Y chromosome haplotype and age, mm-hmm. you have a very reasonable chance of working out who that person is. So just those two bits of data.
Wait, why is this? Because I think I've seen my haplotype, and I didn't know it was that discriminative. Like, it's that, are you going way down? You're not just looking at the level at a 23andMe or a National Geographic.
No, it's the definitive haplotype. And people, the groups that form around different haplotypes with the same surname, and so most of the venters in the U.S. have all had their at least Y chromosome haplotype sequence to find out who's related to who. But you know,
this
is increasing more and more. With your chances are better than 50% of finding a surname just from that. So. But now that we have faces and we have all these other characteristics, the more diverse your ethnicity, the easier the predictions. The most difficult ones to predict are Northern Europeans. So apparently what people have been saying about us all along is that we all look alike. It's kind of true when you try to make discriminations at the genetic level. So, you know, your genome defines you uniquely and precisely, despite what the government says. The government tells people that the NIH can de-identify your genome and protect your identity.
I don't believe that for a second.
It never made sense now we've proven it with that kind of thing. So machine learning is extremely valuable and getting more and more powerful. As we find these commonality in clinical data sets to go right to the genome to find what is the cause of that ailment. And so our goal is over the next decade to solve the nature side of the nature-nurture equation.
Hmm.
The environment's almost infinite. So if you tried just to measure everything in the environment, in fact, it's something you could never solve it. But we should be able to determine everything that's absolutely genetic or it has a major genetic component. And this gets very interesting when it gets into sociology of brain types, personality, mm-hmm. thought types, sexual preferences, sexual identity. et cetera. So,
do you think in that same time, your 10-year time frame, that cellular therapies, gene therapies for either adult modification or germ cell modification or both will be coming?
So everybody first thought after we sequenced the genome and you can know what the defect and the spelling is for a disease, that gene therapy will be the magic thing. You just go correct the spelling. And gene therapy and gene editing would be great if we were a giant single-cell amoeba. Be kind of messy. It'd be like Jabba the Hutt or something.
One thing to fix, right. Yep.
But we have 100 trillion cells, and the reason gene therapy has pretty much failed, except with some specialized cases, is it's been almost impossible to get the correct of that spelling in every one of the 100 trillion cells under the right regulation. And the same is going to be true with genome editing. Mm-hmm. Cells that we can take out of the body, and this has been true for gene therapy as well, so ex vivo therapy, you can take blood cells out, you can modify them out, you can take stem cells out and modify them mm-hmm. and give them back, there looks like some success. And there's been one case, but it's only one case, and not long enough to see whether it's going to last, of changing, doing some editing on somebody's bone marrow cells with sickle cell disease and giving those modified bone marrow cells back, and the person seems at least to be free of sickle cell disease right now. So it's not clear how long that will last, if there's enough stem cells that were modified to make that last. So the only kind of editing that will make a difference will be germline mm-hmm. editing before you're born.
For the next generation.
Yep. For the next generation. And right now that's pure experimentation. And post-World War II, after all the Nazi atrocities, there was sort of a worldwide ban on direct human experimentation without building up and doing safety models first and knowing exactly what will happen. So CRISPR, when people talk about it in the news, they kind of leave off a key detail that it has lots of off-target effects. Mm. So you can use it to try and edit a single base, but it's kind of randomly editing a lot of other things that you don't know what it's doing. And so it's great as a laboratory tool. It's great as a research tool. Mm-hmm. It's a phenomenal advance, but I don't think people will be going into a clinic soon to, you know, undergoing a CRISPR modification right. to change.
So perhaps if you had a tiny subset of your genome in a lab, ex vivo's case, you could, but you would never just apply it to the yeah. entire group.
That's right. So it's, it's going to follow the route of gene therapy, is my guess, mm-hmm. of a lot of hype and hope around it, mm-hmm. and then people are going to find it's hard to impossible.
So if that's not something you're enthusiastic, because I've got to imagine you think about where the diagnostic insights and the application of machine learning, compounding that insight, can lead to better change. You could change your environment, change your diet, perhaps change your microbiome. Do you think that's an area where we'll see great progress?
Well, I mean, the things that everybody preaches of getting exercise and having a reasonable diet, not being obese, those things all make sense. None of those things will tell you whether you have cancer, mm-hmm. whether you have heart disease, whether you're likely to have heart disease. They're smart things to do for everybody, mm-hmm. but you have to do these new things on top of it to really understand your health. So you can take all the vitamin supplements in the world and, you know, exercise every day, and you could still have a giant tumor growing in your lungs that you don't know about. And so we have to use the modern tools of science to see things that help predict the future or detect things, you know, that the tumors that eight people here have that they may not know about for 1 to 5 years till they get big enough and they metastasize to cause them pain or some kind of symptom. It really simplifies and changes people's life. You detect it early, you get rid of it, mm-hmm. and then as long as you're doing these other things of getting exercise and not smoking, you know, the obvious things that everybody predicts and preaches, they're necessary but not sufficient. Mm-hmm. We have to use modern knowledge, modern tools to really understand our health.
So far we've been talking almost entirely about Human Longevity Inc. Your prior company, though, is also doing quite a bit in human health. What's some exciting new work going on there that you can share with us?
So one that's related to human health and to CRISPRs is, we got 10 minutes. Mm-hmm.
Heads up. So while he's answering this, if anyone wants to ask a question, is it these mics? Is that how we want to do it? Feel free to come up to a mic, and then I'll know that someone in the audience has a question, and I'll turn to you. Great. So maybe, but go ahead with this one.
We've been working with United Therapeutics. We're editing the genome of pigs, substituting human genes for pig genes so that xenotransplantation can be used to help the million people in the U.S. that die each year from the lack of organs for transplantation. So
humanizing a pig.
So we're trying to humanize a pig, and we have some jokes on this. I used to call it the Sarah Palin Project.
Lipstick and all.
Yeah. but that's so passe because she's
kind of faded away.
She's kind of faded away in all the latest noise. But we're editing a number of key genes and changing parts of the immune system, et cetera. So we have hearts that last over a year now in baboons, and so...
Wow, that's been done in a baboon already for over a year.
So at Synthetic Genomics, we make new humanized pig cells. United Therapeutics takes those and does nuclear transplantation, just popping out the nuclei and puts it in to a pig embryonic cell that then they grow up live pigs from. And they do breeding, so they have multiple ones of those, and then they use the organs for testing for transplantation.
Amazing.
And there's about 20 parts, everything's from muscles and tendons to heart valves. People have been using pig heart valves, but we think the ones we have particularly will help children. They'll grow with the child. So children that have heart valve replacements have to have multiple open heart surgeries. So we think these will just grow and last with the child.
But all kinds of, heart, lung, everything.
That's right. Lungs are the most difficult. And that was the motivation of Martine Rothschild, who's the CEO and helped fund all this. But we have lungs. They usually didn't last more than a couple minutes.
Wow.
So we have some up now to 48 hours, which doesn't sound great, but compared to where we started. So lung is the most difficult tissues, but kidneys, hearts, livers, it's all looking good. So
that's great. And as everyone probably knows, there's a huge shortage of transplants of humans, people waiting their whole life and to death for a transplant, and this could relieve that.
And so even if hearts only last a year, that keeps somebody alive for a year, well, maybe they move up on the transplant list, or we get them so they last 5 years. So.
Yep. Great. Why don't we take, why don't we start over here, and we'll go back and forth. Yes.
Hi. Dave Maltz, big fan of what you're doing with HLI. In fact, I was the second person through your CT scanner after you, day after.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Obviously, you're looking healthy, so you must be healthy.
Not only am I looking healthy, I'm actually one of the lucky few, definitely on the right side of that 40%. My question is the degree of genetic diversity that you're getting in your database. To what extent do you try to force that diversity and maybe start to broaden out from who's coming in kind of over the transom, if you will? And how do you ensure that you're getting as broad a view of human genetic diversity in your database?
Yeah. No, it's a good question. When we look at the range of ethnogeographic populations we cover, it's extremely diverse, which is surprising. But people fly in from all over the world to go through this process. We constantly want to get more diversity, but we saturated the common alleles in the human population at around 8,000 genomes. So these are the things you get on a 23andMe chip or other things. So so if we sequence anybody's genome now, we'd find around 8,000 variants that would be totally unique to you. Hmm. And it's the rare variants, that the ones that are totally unique to you, that are going to be key for defining your traits and possibly your diseases. So
Literally unique to that one individual?
Yeah.
Just within your sample, or do you think unique within the population?
Well, right now it's unique within the 40,000 database sample. The number of these is getting so high, I think we're over 80 million totally unique variants. Some of those will be shared with a few others, but you know, the number of unique ones keeps going up as we sequence more and more people. So when you think of it, so when we sequenced, they were actually my sperm. Sequencing every sperm cell gave a different answer. No two were alike.
Every sperm is special.
Yeah. And I don't have eggs, but we got them from others. And no two eggs are alike. So every time you combine a sperm with an egg, it's totally a unique experiment. It's just a random crapshoot every single time. And then on top of that, we all have several hundred to several thousand unique random variants that occur in us. So the uniqueness of each of us is truly measurable. We can measure identical twins. They are slightly different from each other. Just some somatic variations when you go from one cell to 100 trillion cells. Mm-hmm. That's why they don't have the same fingerprints. And
copying errors, or?
Yeah, copying errors, mm-hmm. And just, you know, one population gets separated. So as we understand that uniqueness, we will be able to predict more and more about each of our lives. And it's getting to be truly interesting. And when we can apply this to animals like pigs, I think that will help solve some medical issues. But eventually, we'll be able to go the other way.
Excellent. Great. How about over here?
Good afternoon. Thank you, Steve and Craig, for being here and for sharing your valuable time with us. I'm David, and I grew up in a family business at age 13. The family business was a slaughterhouse, so we donated pig parts to Pfizer, actually, in Eastern Connecticut, so I can relate to what you're doing there. I'll get to my question.
I think they ate them, though.
You think Pfizer ate them? Yeah.
The cafeteria supply.
So can you briefly explain to some of us who aren't as familiar with genetics testing the value chain? In other words, there's a testing company, interpretation company, and then there's application. Like, how does that value chain work? And most importantly, how does that fit into the economic models of healthcare today, and especially the concept of early detection and, like you said, testing before we think there might be a problem? How does that fit into maybe the economic model as we have today or going forward?
Well, other than that human longevity, it doesn't fit into too many people's models at all. So we're one of the first few places that does the complete accurate genome to a 30x coverage and put it in a database to compare to all the others. But we link it in every case to phenotype and clinical information. So we've done some work with a number of mathematicians doing some models on this in terms of the kinds of discoveries we're making. The net equations should save the economy literally trillions of dollars. The trouble is, working out that net equation is going to be very difficult, because there are some people whose lives and livelihood is the traditional practice of medicine that don't like detecting things early, taking away what they do.
Downstream revenue.
So a lot of people make money, a huge number of people make money off of the sick population. So we're trying to deal with wellness. We're dealing only with people who are apparently healthy and trying to keep them healthy. versus being a disease-oriented effort. So, you know, third-party payers don't yet exist in this space. Insurance companies are looking at it. Life insurance companies like it. So when you get life insurance, you're betting against yourself. The life insurance company is betting you're going to live longer. We have the data to, in fact, sort out what reality is. So we just announced a big deal with a life insurance company that's encouraging its clients to come get their genome sequenced. The life insurance company doesn't get the data. It just goes to the client, hoping that they'll use it to improve their health status. One major life insurance company that has, you know, 30, 50, $100 million policies is actually offering to pay its clients to go through the health nucleus because, you know, it's pretty easy to do the math. In fact, one of the early people going through that we discovered a tumor in was probably had at least a $30 million life insurance policy. Had we not discovered his tumor that he had no symptoms for, it was removed a week later, he's completely cancer-free. If it was discovered because it metastasized, he probably would have been dead before he was 55. Now he'll probably live to be 90 unless he gets run over by a car. It's not hard to do the net present value of $30 million over 30 years.
That's right.
Plus, he's still paying the premium. So
that's the most important part.
So you can see for life insurance, it's a very simple equation. You want to live a long time. They want you to live a long time. They're now catching on. That makes sense for them to help you live a long time.
Excellent.
Health insurance isn't quite so smart yet. So.
Great. I'm seeing the, is it okay to take the last, okay, this will be our last question.
Yeah, just a quick follow-on. You talked about DNA sequencing and MRI and the review of those. What is the cost?
So right now at the Health Nucleus, it's $25,000 for this comprehensive analysis that includes a comprehensive brain analysis with something called NeuroQuant, whole body MRI, CT scan for calcium in your heart, 4D echo, a neurological test, whole genome, metabolome, microbiome. So it's as comprehensive as you can get. That's $25,000, and it takes 8 hours to collect all that data. We're working and we'll be announcing sometime soon an exciting new version of this that's dramatically cheaper based on some exciting new technology that we're helping make available. So we're likely to be opening lots of smaller versions. The new version will collect everything in less than 2 hours.
The same data set?
Pretty much the same data set, only with some exciting new technologies.
Cool.
We're trying to drive the cost down so more people can participate.
Fantastic. Well, Dr. Vator, thank you so much for coming here today to
we never tell that to our patients. He held up a sign, time's up.
Time's up, yeah. It's over. Pack it in. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was fantastic. I'm going to put you both
on
the spot here
because
we had such a rich conversation about advancements in genomics. Trailblazed by you, of course. And then we started talking a little bit about policy or at least some sort of insurance, bringing the business side of it. So today was supposed to be the day that the House was going to vote on the Republican plan. So my question is, if you were an advisor, President Trump calls you both in and saying, we would really like to advance some of what you're doing, and we really think it's preventative, we need to get more people screened, what would be one policy advice you would give to him?
Please resign.
Hard to beat that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You know, I probably should just leave it at that.
Let me give you a medical answer. So the most important part about what President Obama did was the no pre-existing conditions. That changed so many people's lives that were getting denied coverage because they already had a disease. So if you put that in the context of what we're finding, everybody has a pre-existing condition. So if that goes away, basically half our population will be screwed.
So keep that in, keep that provision. I think that's they're keeping that in as a provision. So that's good.
I'm not really sure, and I try really hard not to think about this, but in general, it is obvious we need to re-engineer FDA and Medicare simultaneously so that reimbursement policy and approval are simultaneous, and that you have a pathway from where we are today to a future of personalized medicine, regenerative medicine, where the frameworks just make absolutely no sense. Japan has started some regulatory reform in that regard. I think the whole system needs to be re-engineered from scratch, and perhaps one way to make some progress there is somewhat similar to what they do in China, where they'll have in different provinces different experiments that go on. If we could have an FDA-free zone, if you will, a region where if you move there, you are signing up to a regulatory environment where you have to take things on.
I think that used to be called
Berkeley. Yes, exactly. Embrace that and enroll with some more. We need massive experimentation and a whole new system. Yep.
Great.
Yep.
Did you have anything else to say?